The subject announced here is very serious, and you probably imagine how vast it is. Because if we speak about Orthodoxy only, here is an ocean without boundaries. When we speak about non-Orthodoxy, we mean all those non-Orthodox, but Christian beliefs, which are now in great number. I'd like to tell you at once that alongside the genuine preach of Christianity, which sounded at first from apostles themselves in the first century, those people who heard something about Christianity, some from apostles, the others from those who had listened to apostles, the third ones, perhaps through some other third hands. So you may notice that at the beginning, refraction of Christianity started in the consciousness of many people. This refraction or interpretation bore a distorted character. They seemed to speak about Christ. They seemed to understand that everything was linked with the gospel, or at least with those gospels that had been known already, and later on they were recorded in written form. Then happened a surprising branches of this tree. The branching was not on the same tree. So what do we mean by Orthodoxy? All those Christian confessions are those who hold the Bible in their hands. That is Old and New Testament. They hold in their hands, they raise it high and say, "We are Christians," despite there, in the large measure, they do not agree with the Orthodoxy. These disagreements are sufficiently many, and sometimes they are of principled character. From here arises a very serious question. What is Orthodoxy and what is not Orthodoxy? When we usually start considering this subject, people used to ask one and the same question. What about non-Orthodox? Will they be saved? Catholics, Lutherans, Baptists, Pentecosts, there are many of these branches. The first question that is being asked, will they save themselves? As you see, the question is outstanding, and in order to answer it, we'd better find out, what does it mean to save? And under what conditions does this salvation take place? What is salvation? You should realize at this meeting, we'll not dwell on what certain non-Orthodoxy teachings on the subject, and that is senseless and that is impossible. But the issue is of utmost importance. What is the pivot of both Orthodoxy and non-Orthodoxy? And what is salvation? And under what conditions it is committed? According to what criteria we may judge about one thing or another? This issue acquires a special topicality, bearing in mind the fact that it is the non-Orthodox beliefs that not only have acquired a complete freedom in this country, and we have no objections to that, but they have not only received a complete freedom, but they are getting more and better conditions in the sense of disseminating of their teaching. The reasons behind that are quite of different order, but technically speaking, they are very quick to penetrate into the TV, radio. On some locations, they purchase these channels, and in this case, naturally, they advocate Christianity in their own vein. So, what is this and what is that? Just imagine if any of you sitting here would take a recorder and on a Sunday or on a festive day would approach our Orthodox, sincerely Orthodox, who have just prayed at the liturgy, and would ask them questions concerning their religious doctrine. You perhaps realize what it will be. then you would probably ponder whether they are Orthodox or not. They are mistaken in this and that. And they would tell you a lot of such things that you might think, what are they? If you approach non-Orthodox church with the same question, for instance, Catholic, Protestant, you will confront the same picture. Very few people know their religious doctrine.
Своё вероучение, и это прежде всего,
and above all, I would say, not moral admonition, but spiritual life. Moral admonition, this is more or less the same. The same situation. What is amazing that people everywhere, when they are asked what is Christianity, will respond in the same way. That is the belief in Christ, observance of the ordinary commandments. Unfortunately, by these commandments, they mean the commandments given to Moses. So, astonishingly, they were given long time ago. A matter of long standing doesn't change the validity, but the point is different. These commandments indicate to the most obvious things and to the crimes of the clear-cut character. Take for one, don't kill. Well, it is clear for all. Don't steal. Don't commit adultery. Such things which are on the surface, which are obvious, and everyone can realize and learn. These things seem to be known by everyone. But as soon as they probe into the teaching of one or rather confession in a deeper way, here you will find yourself into the gap. A question arises, and who will be saved, and under what conditions? Just a formal belonging. I go to a Christian church, and next to it there is a Catholic or Lutheran church. Does this matter? Or someone recognizes Pope and someone doesn't. Is it due to this reason only? And if both of them conduct a very moral life, what is the matter? What is the significance of what is hidden in the name? Right, the name has nothing to do with it. There are things that could be called things of the fundamental order, and these things exactly draw a line between orthodoxy and non-orthodoxy. In essence, in order to understand all that, we must solve the problem, what is it, salvation, and who will be saved? Well, the matter is not in the name. Initially, there were no names in the church. Christians and that all. And who will be saved? And what is salvation? That is the major issue. Until we comprehend this, we'll not be able to answer whether all the Christians will be saved and whether all non-Christians will be perished.
Не можем, правда же. Что же такое спасение?
So, what is salvation and under what condition will it happen? Moreover, pay attention. The first man who entered the paradise, what did he know? What did he know? Do you remember who entered the first? A criminal, offender, scoundrel. Really, he was as such. He enters the paradise. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. By the way, pay attention to the fact, what a striking phenomenon. Christianity or Christ stated what contradicts all religions of the world without exception. I hope we all understand that. You may ask now anyone, will a criminal or a scoundrel be saved? Of course, they will say no. Of course not. How he could be saved? Are you kidding? A representative of any religion will tell you about it, and we suddenly witness such a fact. We've been accustomed to, and we do not pay attention to, but that is a staggering challenge to all our consciousness, to all our conceptions about God. If you like to ask about the religion, about the truth of anything, Christianity named something that has never taken place in the history of the mankind. Not anyone could even imagine in his or her thoughts. They didn't know what is God. They didn't know. Yes, they believed he existed. Yes, they brought him sacrifices. They believed. And who he was, they had a most general idea. He can punish if you live badly. If you live adequately, he may show mercy. To show mercy doesn't mean to award, and to show mercy under the condition that you can propitiate him. By what? By some deeds, by some sacrifices, some gifts. I remember when being in India, we dropped at the Hinduism temple, and there was a huge, remarkably made image of a giant serpent. Swung like this, utterly realistic, a startling art, a head of this serpent, a tongue sticking out. Priest sings his praises with a sandal incense in front of his head. To be frank, the whole picture is mystically terrifying. A giant serpent of that thickness, made of stone, of black basalt, and prizes with sandal incense you are sent. If you could only see that. All people believe that God could be propitiated, and in this respect he is like us, people. He might be insulted, he might be infuriated, and then be aware. A thunder and the lightning will fall on your head, and you will know what is it to insult God or godness. For a deity in its highest religious conception, the Old Testament, the Bible religion was as such. A deity or God is fair. He gives his blessings. To those making good, he punishes evil doers. But he can be merciful if you are able to make some deeds, bring some sacrifices, then he can change his anger for mercy. Here is a limit, an end. Do you understand what is a deity? Clear. Christianity speaks about quite different things. I put it strongly, different things, but really principally different. It turns out that is a wrong notion. God is not like this. God possesses different qualities, quite different. Just imagine. We are pondering whom we believe in. Just think, whom we believe in. And if you like, in what God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. What is this? How did he give his Son? If we read the Gospel, he who could do everything and prove by his deeds up to resurrection of the four-day Lazarus who was stinking, Jesus Christ, God and man, he voluntarily gave himself into the hands of scoundrels, these villains, who could have beaten him with stones. Yes, and it was just easy. And he will die at once. No, crucify him. That means to hand him over to the most terrifying tortures, which were known, a terrible act. He voluntarily accepts it. For the sake of salvation, for the salvation of people.
берет на себя то, что...
He undertakes upon him what is absolutely unexplainable, and he knows what it is.
Решится умереть, то разве только...
So, Apostle Paul writes correctly, if someone dares to die, that is only in case for making a sacrifice for his benefactor, true benefactor, but to die for those who hate him, who insult him, who crucify him, who constantly violate him. Imagine to die for him. Words from the cross. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. He sees something from the height of the greatness, something what is happening. Forgive them. It is these small foibles that they're bearing malice, hate, kill. They do not know what they're doing. Father, forgive them. So really, fathers of the church, we may come across such words, and I think they are fair, that terrible picture, which you might recall, those who saw Mel Gibson's film, recall those terrifying tortures Christ was subjected to. So the fathers say that through this cross, through this horror,
люди смогли увидеть, не просто услышать,
people could see, not only to hear, they could see and made sure that God is not justice. No, no. How meanly it is, fairness. God is love. Love, not justice. Justice executes some people. For the others, it shows mercy. He is love which doesn't know either evil or vengeance. What it means love? What love is meant? We mean not emotions that are expressed simply. We either love some and hate others. We do not mean emotions. What is meant is love sacrificial, that is love to the utmost, to the end, to the death. If you want God and man. It turns out that God is love. Here is what Christianity opens. And how this love manifested itself. That should be realized in what this love showed itself. In the greatest humility. To the utmost. It would mention such generosity if it could be interpreted into our common rough language. This generosity, generosity of the soul that ignores these minor insults, deeds, deaths. It covers everything, for it looks only at the benefit of a person. God turns to be a love. A love which is indulgent to the limit of humility, to forgive its insulters. We are all sinful and we kill differently, yes, kill differently. Some kill materially, the others kill mentally. We do differently, some of us directly, the others indirectly. The very censure of the other people is an arrow into this man, is already a shot in him, and a shot. Do you understand what kind? I would not do it. Do you hear? I would not do it, but he is a scoundrel. So you see how far better I am from this scoundrel. No generosity here. We cannot rise higher than this earth, this plane. Saint Fathers say, God has revealed us the greatest truth by this cross, which mankind had never known, and which, alas, we have not known so far. that God is love and only love. That is the greatest truth. Who is God? God is not a certain being that is sitting somewhere in, well, I don't know on what constellation, and is looking from there and is ordering some or other, or what we must do and what must be done. God is spirit. All of us live, move, and exist owing to Him. He is spirit, like everything is in the law of gravity. All of us are in God, and it turns out that that is the most peaceful, universal law of the human being, that sacrificial love, which pursues only benefit and good for every person. This love happens to be true, and how is it shown? It seems to us, say, God could seize us by the scuff of the neck and push us to paradise. Do, sit there. Don't you see how good it is here? And you used to crawl on the ground. No, a striking thing. Not the slightest pleasure, but the fact is a man will not give back, will not respond to this love by his love. And what is meant? Not only gratitude, we mean the truth. Don't you see this beauty? Can't a man respond to this amazing beauty by the beauty of his life and soul, by the truth? In a contrast to a lie, which we commit continuously, looking at this truth, could a man respond to the good by good and to the evil by good? Freedom of human being, freedom of each is not violated, not a jot. God is called upon by love, only by love. God is not a czar who executes and shows mercy, who can do anything you want. Christianity declared a striking truth that God can do to a single man either evil or good without the man's wish, without his determined participation, without his aspiration. I can do nothing, but I'm striving for it. God responds then. God gives. Everything is given to an open heart. Only a knock is given to the closed heart. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him, and he with me. It turns out that there is no violence in God's actions towards man. I draw your attention. What we're speaking about? What is salvation? What is salvation we're talking about? What is it? Has a man been saved or not? Will he be saved or not? How to answer this question? How to interpret, to understand what we're talking about? What is that X about whom we are guessing? God is spirit. What spirit? That spirit that has shown, as far as is it possible for a human consciousness, that that peaceful law of the human being, a law within which we could really be in the utmost good. What kind of law is it, if you like, to unite with God? Make ourselves in one spirit with God. Do you hear we say unanimously? Unanimous with God. In what? God is absolute love. He showed that there is an absolute humility. Think, humility. He is beaten. He says, if I am not right, say that I am not right. But if I am right, what are you striking me for? Do you hear this humility practically differs from a servant's submissiveness or obedience, Your Highness, at your service? No, no, humility is fulfilled with an amazing human dignity. Think how he behaves. Pilate asks him, he keeps silent and answers nothing. Do you remember, Pilate is startled and astounded. Just think. Our distorted notion about humility often slides down into some servant obedience. There is nothing in common. That is a striking force. Who do you think is stronger, he who would hit back in return when he is struck, or that one who, upon seeing that there, would do nothing, and he would rise above all that and wouldn't answer? Do you remember Dostoevsky Idiot? Do you remember Prince Myshkin? When Rogozin struck him, how did Prince Myshkin react? What have you done? Not meaning he had struck him, but saying, what have you done? He meant, you will suffer greatly because of that. Of course, to strike Prince Myshkin, this innocent man, a saint man, who wouldn't hurt a mosquito, and suddenly he had been struck. You have really done it with yourself, were the words. And we know what happened with Rogozin. What suffering he had undergone, connected even with this every moment. So, you see what we're arriving at. What is salvation? Salvation, if we think that God is the greatest goodness. In fact, and what is higher than love? Let someone tell us. Love is a joy. Love is beautiful. Love is everything. It's the utmost of everything. Even at our purely human level, that shadow of God's love cannot be compared with our human love. Recall Aida. I'm ready to live in a shelter of branches. I'll go away from the palace, put me in a bricked pit, I'll die. Even this is love. And all those who felt God's love, everyone unanimously say that this love is like God. When it enters a man, it becomes a certain fire, purifying all human passions. What else could be said? Only one thing. It surpasses everything, that all that we could imagine, and no earthly love can be compared with it. That is true. The earthly love is changeable. Here is a man is joined to unchangeable eternal love, which surpasses everything. You see, God is love. This is striking humility. Humility, you see, for the sake of love, goes to the extremes. But he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in a human likeness. So meaning a slave, the last one, and he says, do you think I cannot call on my father? And he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels. Put your sword back in its place for all.
И никогда больше не поднимай его. Поднявший меч,
who draw the sword will die by the sword.
Оказывается, совсем другой, о другом совсем.
Not by force, not by pressure. What is meant is another principle of being.
Что такое спасение?
What is salvation? Salvation is a unanimous being, being in the same spirit with God. When is it reached, this being in the same spirit? It is reached according to a principle. A likeness is joined with likeness. Water cannot combine with oil. Water with water, it goes excellently. Here is God likeness. If we turn to the writings of those people, the greatest scholars and scientists who studied not the material, not the atoms, not molecules, who studied the human soul, studied not only by common sense, but experimentally. They tested themselves. They became like rabbits on who experiments were made. Making upon themselves these tremendous experiments. But these experiments are not from the wind, not taken just from somebody's head. They followed what they had found in the Gospel. And we find an amazing phenomenon, which they talked about very often. These people speak about the same not knowing each other, not meeting each other in private, even not hearing about each other anything. They belong to different epochs, different nations. These people are from different nations, from Egypt, Asia Minor, Greece, Rome, Russia, different countries. All these people have taken this program under the name the Gospel, and they started to implement. They came to one and the same staggering result. Which result? They all speak about the fact that under the condition of correct spiritual life, to which the Gospel indicates, all our passions and foibles are dying away, the ones from which we suffer so much. Passion means suffering. Our bare nerves are cured. As you know, hardly someone touches us will immediately burst out, and in that case everything is covered by healthy flesh. A man is cured, a man is healed, and as soon as we acquire humility, and that is a separate talk, a man is communed with God's love, communed. By commune, he is united gradually with God's Spirit. He becomes Godlike. You may say that you may live whatever program you choose, but the results achieved will be the same. True, only what? True, all those who lived according to principles, maybe according to a beautiful life, they all came to the same results. It depends what results. Here, if we turn to the history of the Church, something strikes us. Those people in Church boundaries, they did not only spoke about something. Their deeds, their bodies expressed something unique. Their actions were surprising for all the people around them. Their faces were elucidated. You know that. It is a fact. You don't think that Serafim of Serov had that enlightened face when he met Motovilov, and when Motovilov saw that his face, it was shining like a sun. A face could really be elucidated. It may shine like a sun. You know, when monastic vows are taken in our lavra, we used to witness how a person's face changes. It is fantastically noticeable. You look at the person, familiar face, and suddenly it changes. And quite involuntary, a special feeling towards him is being developed. He is so enlightened. And it seems, what particular is about all this? In our past, he crawled beneath. They read certain prayers about him, that's probably all. And some of them remain as they were before. But others, you may look and wonder, how fantastically they changed. What is this? Some psychological analysis. Where is it from? This I'm talking about simple people. Some time passes and this enlightenment dies away from many. But we mention the people whom Church calls venerable. There is God-likeness, but this is venerability. The church, by this, testifies about that enlightenment which could happen with a man. If we speak about these people, we'll find a lot of facts what happened with them. Take, for example, Sisoy the Great. What is written about him in Patharic? Before the death, his face was enlightened and was written exactly like this. When his brethren gathered around him, they couldn't look at his face. It was shining like a sun. And what were they astonished with? Suddenly, this man, at whom it was impossible to look because of this shining, suddenly they hear his words. This man is asking something from God. What are you asking for? They said. I'm asking God for some more time for repentance, was the answer. Sisoy, mustn't you repent? That is, when it was impossible to look at him. Do you know the answer? Striking. Fathers, I do not know whether I have given rise to my repenting. What do you think during these last minutes before death? Could it be a phrase mongering? Even the very idea of that was impossible. This is the very person at whom it was impossible to look, said, I don't know whether I have given rise to my repentance. I don't know whether I have given rise to my repenting. Here is what he was praying for, to give him some more time. Love is in him. He wants again and again express his gratitude. More, as it is possible to purify himself. Why? You will say, how to purify oneself? Yes. Purify, of course. Could it be achieved while we are here on earth? Isn't it possible to think about achieving absolute holiness, purity? No, no. Here we are changeable. Even great saints are changeable, not only we. By the way, one of the most objective signs of humility is the awareness of this self-corruption, awareness of self-instability. How I am prepared to love the whole world, but in an instant I am prepared to destroy the whole world, so good we are. Do you remember the phrase from Dostoevsky? He writes, try and place me next to the best man, the best you can only find in the world for a day, and I'll hate him by the end of the day with a savage hatred. He, of course, exaggerated, but he wonderfully showed that what is in our soul, how changeable we are. So Sisoy begged. It was not phrase mongering. That was cri de coeur. God, give me some more time for repentance. What a desire of purity. Whether is it present with us? Well, I'll come. I'll name my sins and that's all. And the intention to purify. Do I really have it? Only not to stain it with anything. It's like a woman when she is dressed in a glittering white dress, cleanly white. How careful she is in order not to stain it with anything. Of course, she sees this purity. Same people who achieved vision of this purity, how much they wanted that there would be no insane deeds. What we have in real life? Wherever you set your foot, organ splashes are dispersed. Here I didn't act properly. Here I said something bad. Oh, I prayed not in the way I should. There was about to condemn someone. I don't know what is there in the souls of different people, different levels. Don't think once he is called a saint that all the same people are the same. Not in the least. As Apostle Paul wrote, the sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another, and the star differs from star in splendor. It is us who use one word, saint. We canonize them as saints. In reality, there could be an endless distance between them, between those whom the Church names saints. An important question arises. Who should we apply to? Whom should we follow? Whom should we take the teaching from and take those from the Church calls venerable? They are the greatest psychologists of the world. They showed the example of the spiritual life. They indicated that beauty that, unfortunately, we don't feel in us. Macarius the Great, whom fathers called an earthy god, said that he had seen neither on earth nor in the sky such a great beauty as a human soul, and we don't see it. And if we do not see anything, especially in other people, ugliness or outrage, and in ourselves, if we don't see beauty, I'd rather not mention. In others we see only ugliness. At least we see it more than beauty. In reality, by nature, there's nothing more beautiful than the human soul. By nature, because a man is a crown, a peak of creation. That is the most sophisticated creation. Higher angels, seraphims, altars, cherubims, and everyone on the earth that was created. Above all by nature. Do you hear what was given to a man? True, a man is staying in a condition far from this likeness. And that is another question. So all the saints, all these venerable, they open us the way and they show us what is the essence of man's salvation. What is that very orthodoxy which we are speaking about? What is orthodoxy? They say that it consists in acquisition by a man or his awareness of that very condition to which we assigned, and we assigned a word, but we don't know by experience, unfortunately, that condition of humility. What is it expressed in? It is expressed in cognition of how we are unstable, far stumble persistently, how we wallow in mud, in this fuss, vanity, in sins, in everything. Moreover, we are incapable to get out of this pool. We can do nothing. And moreover, we don't do anything. That recognition by man, by his actual being in a condition in which he must not be. What is sinfulness? Sinfulness is the state in which a man must not be. This is how in a certain story a man kept on planning, and suddenly a knot or a hitch or a board is piled. What is sin? That is what must not be. Even in Greek, a sin means a blunder, a slip. To miss a target, you shoot and missed. They do what they must not do, the most important condition. When we speak about salvation, as the acquisition by a man, that awareness of his condition, in which he must not be, incorrectness of his life, if it is compared with that one which is prescribed by the Gospel, which we see in Christ, in the lives, records of the saint people. But I'd say more. Do you hear? I'd say more. Our consciousness say much more. But unfortunately, it speaks about something very rough, very rude, and sometimes less. If we start fighting medium-sized blunders, perhaps we'll start fighting with more minor. Maybe that is a gradual process, if only a man could be engaged in that. Unanimous evidence of fathers, he who sincerely made up his mind to live according to a Christian way of life. What does that mean, Christian way of life? Not only to do some Christian deeds. Perhaps you are in prison and you don't know anything. Can you resolve there in prison to lead a Christian way of life? You are having a life sentence till death. Can you? That is life, that is not what we do with our hands, feet, with a tongue, not in the least, a civil life. Life is a life spiritual. What is being committed in your soul? What is there in your soul? And we know what is being made in the soul, good thing and bad, everything there. Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within us. Macarius of Egypt writes that hell is within us. There is a man's heart. It is the receptacle of both. Depending on what? Depending on a man. Salvation starts when a man gradually starts seeing his sinfulness. This vision is the starting point of a person's conversion to faith, his sincere addressing God. If we use a purely theological expression, it might sound boring, but these theologians are engaged in these things. So theologically it is communion with God. Well, you know, that's what we got. We know nothing. Communion. True. But how this communion is possible when we open doors to Christ, knocking at the door? How shall we be able to open the doors? So the major condition, so to say, the main status of my soul is when we want to speak about salvation, is the cognition of our sinfulness. Objective, not under pressure, nothing artificial. Save God. I say, I am a sinful person, sinful. If only you come up to this sinful, if you see sincerely, no hypocrisy or archness. A man starts seeing, I can't help condemning. Just think, I can't help condemning. Though I understand perfectly well that by act of condemning, I am elevating myself over the other person. That is, arrogance speaks in myself. Yes, I confess that arrogance, but what is arrogance? That is, to cut a tree to the feet on which you are sitting. The most disgusting thing. This element, arrogance, this manifestation of selfness, it lowered a man from the heaven. You will be like gods. Here is the temptation. Arrogance is the most horrifying thing. It manifests itself constantly and endlessly, to say nothing that we don't simply condemn, but with that hostility, with that sense of an evil. And how different we treat our neighbors, how inattentive we are towards our own soul, how we cut it, how we prick it. I don't know what we can only do with it by our inner abominations or disgusting things. Do you hear? I pay your attention once more that being alone in a solitary cell and with life imprisonment, what could I be engaged in? What could I do? We don't speak about outer deeds. We speak about something spiritual things. Do you know when Metropolitan Arseniy Matsievich, who was indignant with reforms introduced by Catherine II, who didn't recognize them and who rejected them, what happened? She revenged herself on him in the most cruel form. He was arrested. This metropolitan clothes were torn away from him, and he was sent to a monastery as a monk. The more and more cruel the self conditions were becoming. In the town of Tallinn in Estonia, they show that tower where he was put into a tiny single cell, quite tiny, miserable. Nobody dared even to say a word. The cell itself manifested their sufferings. They opened the door, put something before him, and left. He didn't see a man's face. He didn't hear a human's voice. He spent in those tortures dozens of years. And you know what was found after his death? On the wall, it was scratched out. Blessed is he who humbled us. He was a strong man. He understood that that was not a pure accident. Catherine was only a tool in the hands of God's will. She couldn't do anything without God's will. Blessed is God who humbled me. Just think, what a great many thoughts had passed through his soul. So orthodoxy comes down to that. One of the saints used to say, the first sign of the coming reasoning of the soul is seeing your own sins. Sinfulness, this what must not be. This saying completely changes my attitude towards the other people, completely changes. I begin to understand how I am ill and how they're ill. From here, there could arise only one feeling of that of generosity. A sick person have a compassion for another sick person. He helps, not condemns. Do you hear? Out of the feeling of your own unfitness, the greatest human feeling arises. Love, yes, where the sprouts could appear. What does orthodoxy speaks about this? In this connection, it asserts the man who opens the doors towards this, who sees himself in this very unworthiness, unfitness of his doing wrongly, he who has some seeds of love, probably, they have not sprung yet, but this man is saved. A criminal was not doing anything. He was on the cross. Do you remember what he said? Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. You, Jesus, remember me. I will not be there. You know, you see what cognition of your own unworthiness, your sinfulness, and sincere address to God. What humility. You remember me there. He knows. He has no doubts that he will not be there. It is a pious one who was crucified. I will not be there because I know I'm a scoundrel. And he gets a striking answer. You will be with me in paradise today. This is impossible to compare with any thunder. Something unprecedented is comprised by these words. A scoundrel enters the paradise first, humbled to the limit. You see, in what is the orthodoxy? I don't speak about any dogmas. I want to say, what is orthodoxy? Yes, of course, orthodoxy has a system of religious doctrine. Here is hierarchy, that is all true. But this all exists in other confessions, despite their differences. True, we need to know our religion's doctrine. Not knowing it, people easily fall into superstition, heathenism, paganism, in magic, in witchcraft, or anything, during sects, not knowing orthodox doctrines, wherever they might go. But the most important is what they don't know is the most important. That is humility and love being born from it. They saved a man, a criminal. Christ put some of these higher than these theologians, priests, archbishops, high priests, monasticism. He has put them higher. What people? A public woman? What is that? An anger against Christ is understandable. He has overthrown religion and faith. Here is what orthodoxy. I decided to tell it in this way. What is the difference with non-orthodoxy? Of course it differs. Both religion, doctrines and church arrangement and hierarchy, they're a bit different, right? And many other things. I'll not tell you about that. These are certain consequences, and even more. But that is secondary. We are all mistaken, all of us Orthodox. Do you think we know our creed well?
Ангел бы с неба слетел бы какой-нибудь, так, и
принял бы экзамен всех профессоров богословия. An exam on religious doctrine, testing all professors of theology. And then he would say, all must go to infernal regions, they should go to the underground, all heretics, all. What do you know? We can only boast. We don't know anything. We are like shadows. Doctrines are like certain carcass. We need it. But creed must be known to teachers, leaders. They must know how to keep this faith, not to let it sprawl away, not to let it go aside. Carcass is needed, a very firm carcass, but carcass is not a building, not at all. For people who are not professionally involved in it, they must be aware of it. Here is what is salvation. Here is where is orthodoxy. How humility is achieved? Once again, by compulsion yourself to life, an honest life, according to the gospel. Симеон, the new theologian, pronounced these remarkable words. Thorough fulfillment of Christ's commandments teaches a man his feebleness. Here is what is open to a man. What is, where is the orthodoxy? In what? In compulsion yourself to a spiritual life. Not only to put candles and order malebans, or go to a church and move a hand. Sorry for using these words. But you do understand me. This could be good, but all this is good when a person has a sincere desire to fulfill an evangelistic beginning in life, in his own life. What is non-orthodoxy? In what way does it differ from orthodoxy? And here we find quite a different picture, unfortunately. The very teaching about God, think, this is important in this case, the understanding of God. Pay attention. Catholicism, merits are requested from God. A person must bring satisfaction to God's justice, and these, I believe, the fundamental truths which differ Catholics from Orthodox. This is not a pope or anything else.
Это прежде всего. А знаете, почему прежде всего? Почему? Я надеюсь, теперь уже это понятно, сейчас станет совершенно понятно. Потому что когда я только произнес слово
«заслуги», вы чувствуете? When I pronounce the word merits, do you feel that I'm a merited person?
Я что-то сделал.
I made something, I have brought satisfaction to God's justice. Понимаете? Do you understand?
А если я сделал еще больше, чем это требуется?
If you do even more, then it is required, I'll commit a super merit, an awful teaching, a murderous teaching about my merits before God and even super merits. Murderous. Those who reject, do you remember how the words of Christ were interpreted? If you want salvation, fulfill the commandments. He fulfilled. Then it was sent to the young man. If you want to be perfect, go, sell your possessions and give to the poor and follow me. They interpreted. How did they interpret? One thing is salvation. The other thing is super merits. Think if you happen to be a monk, merits. Just imagine a person who take monastic vows. I take, I understand, I commit super merit. I may simply keep the commandments like all, but I do more. Than that, I renounce all, now I become he who has supermerits in the very root. You see, in the very root, they kill what is the most important. This is seeing your unworthiness, your sinfulness. From here, the complete misunderstanding. What is meant to keep the commandments, to stick to them? Who? Sisoy the Great begs God to give him more time for repentance. Great Sisoy. In church, there are not so many people who are called great, Macarius the Great. You know, those who read the morning prayers, they know that prayer. God, purify me, sinful, I have never done good before you. Do you hear what Saint Fathers write? And here suddenly, merits. Where is it, this fulfillment? Who has fulfilled? There is no man who would purify his soul completely, to become unchangeable, to become saint and pure. Saint people saw it, cried for it, begged that and reached surely striking God-likeness. It turns out that I may satisfy God's justice, interesting justice. Think. The word itself, justice, the separated love from court, isn't it understandable? What is God acts according to justice? Just think. I act as per justice, it doesn't mean as per love. If so, if act not according to love, so it means not according to justice. In any case, it turns out that God does something that is not quite right. They separated love and truth and God. They didn't understand and they don't understand. This, by the way, we may find in our doctrines. Say, Metropolitan Macarius and in many others, about God's truth, about God's love, don't we understand that God's love is just? Not truth and love in God, but pure love. What does that mean, pierce? Correct. Correct, bringing us benefit and only benefit. Good and only good. Not truth and love. What will win on the scales? I repeat, by truth, all is not by love. By love means unfair. They don't understand. We are surprised what kind of ideas they have. This is Catholic theology. I repeat once again, what lies in the root? So it happens, that is, to have merits. The more person ties himself up with certain deeds, the more merits he has before God. What a horrible thing. It goes as far as supermerits. There exists a depository of good deeds, and Roman Pope disposes of it. A certain man, for one, cannot do such things, but he can get an indulgence from a pope, and the pope may give him something from his depository of supermerits. By this reimbursing the shortage and satisfying God's justice, and the pope may give him something from his depository of supermerits, by this reimbursing the shortage and satisfy God's justice. Homyakov was right 1,000 times when he said Catholicism is a constant court with God, bargaining with God. You will give me and I will give you. You to me and I'll to you. Debit, credit. To understand what a trouble, what a harm. I'm not speaking about any dogmas. I'll tell you one thing, that there is not a single truth. I don't know, maybe I'm a bit exaggerating, but I believe there is not a single specifically Christian truth in which we would not find discrepancies and sometimes principally different views between Orthodoxy and Catholicism. On all the truths of Christian belief, that is an amazing thing. Now I'm saying about the major thing, by means of what a man is being saved, and we know by what means what is happening in non-Orthodoxy, in Catholicism, your opinion about yourself is poured down into the root. What a bad idea. What comes out of it is absolutely clear. What it could result in is absolutely clear. It is not by chance that some fathers of the Eastern Church reproached Catholicism, namely with this during the whole history. If you recall splendid Russian saints, at least those ones of the 19th century, first of all, Ignatius Brinchaninov, whose jubilee we mark this year, 200 years since his birth and 140 years since he passed away. This great teacher, a great spiritual leader, if we turn to him, here is what he says. He explains clearly, these great saints of the Catholic Church are crazy people. Well, do you think he wanted to insult them? Not in the least. He said, like any psychiatrist would say in this case, he did not use the word crazy, but he mentioned psychiatrist. It is a psychiatrist that should be given the task to analyze what is happening with these people. When a certain angel falls down in Roman Catholic Church and starts screaming, beating by her feet and hands and crying, my beloved fiancé, where do you go? And I cannot live without you. She is being grasped by nuns. They carry her away because it is a sin and a shame. When Teresa the Great, do you hear, the Great, says that Christ had appeared to her and appeared many times and then says that she told him, before I was your God, now I am your spouse. Amazing. What is happening? But don't think that is all. It goes on, they take monastic vows, start their activities, and this natural feeling, inherent to every woman, as well as to every man, these natural feelings suddenly stuck out in a place they should not get out. A teapot needs soldering, not to have a steam jet spurtling in the wrong place. It spurts. He, Christ, is not an image, not anymore, like heavenly fiancé. You all of us understand the difference between a fiancé and a spouse. Here is a spouse is calling such a piercing whistle, she says. That is impossible not to hear that. My soul is about to faint because of desire, she adds. I constantly cite these examples, you know. The same happens with small Teresa, just the same. One and the same turnout, the same leading idea. Romances, romances, and romances. What mental driving them actually to the ecstasy? To the ecstasy of the so-called love. And this is called a love to God. Do you understand what awful things? What is really in question? What about awareness of one's selfness? There are words, but there is no the most important thing that is bad. Do you see what is not Orthodoxy, as in Catholicism, in Protestantism, not in the least better, maybe even worse, unfortunately. And all this is evident in most striking things. I mention this not in a single occasion. Imagine we sit talking and suddenly hear. Yes, a person who believes can be forgiven all sins of the past, the present, and the future. Well, it's okay that we are sitting. If not, we would have fallen down and asked for the tincture of valerian, sedative medicine. Everything is forgiven. Hurrah! The issue is solved. It is resolutely solved. Now I have the right not to do anything. Luther announced that you are a blockhead, a pillar of salt. You can't do anything. Christ only can do. If you have come to faith, he will do everything. A faith itself is given by Christ. Think, everything is wonderful and nothing could be done. An everlasting problem is solved, because do you know what do all the religions demand? You must do something in order to stick to something. Here you don't need to do anything. I am a believer, my future sins are forgiven as well. In my life I can only show only what? Whether I have this faith or not. But how? By some good deeds. But the thing outer deeds are the indication of the inner condition of the soul. Well, I have been elected to the State Duma. Do you know what kind of a believer I would have shown of myself? I would have called the TV and start making circles around the churches, putting candles during all the time of TV programs. I will negotiate with archbishops and all would say, what a great believer he is. And all the Orthodox go and vote for him. Then, after being elected, I would say, I don't care, I have nothing to do with all of you. Of course, I'm kidding, but in fact, how many things are being done by us? But what are the reasons for that? They cannot even be listed. The point is not the deeds, but the condition of your soul. That is where the essence is. Protestantism has completely forfeited it. This is only natural, because nothing is needed. Everything is determined dogmatically. What else is needed? Here I'll read out an interesting phrase, what Saint Ignatius writes. Writings made by Luther are unbearable, not only for a pious, but for a decent reader. Do you hear something strange, isn't it? Unquote. They breathe the most gross debauched. If his teaching and many followers, the reasons behind it could be first, right, personal, secondly, political motives, and in the crowd, the absolute ignorance. Meanwhile, Lutheranism gives much opportunities, wishing to commune with God as less as possible, and to limit oneself in one's carnal desires as less as possible. Do you think these are just words? Here I quote one of the letters where he wrote, soul doesn't participate in voluptuous deeds, which the body gives itself up to. The soul is not defiled by them. Hurrah! At last, thank God, you can do what you wish. The soul is not defiled. You may lead a deprived life, go to the polar houses. Just wonderful. Soul is not defiled. Do you hear Ignatius Brinchanino didn't talk at random? And what Luther said to his wife, by the way, she was the former nun, and Luther was a monk, and they married. So he asked his wife one day whether she considered herself saint. Good question, isn't it? When Catherine, that was her name, answered that being sinful, she could not consider herself as such, Luther exclaimed in indignation. Here is the damned influence of papism. We are all saints in our faith. Do you hear? We are all saints. What repentance or what spiritual efforts could we speak about if what is meant? We are all saved. Where else shall we go? Nowhere. You might imagine that that concerns Lutheranism. Oh, no. No, you should not do so if you think so. Lutheranism is, by the way, Protestantism, closer to Catholicism, well, I'd say more Orthodox-like. The most Orthodoxy teaching among Protestants is Lutheranism. All the rest you'd better not mention. I'll be very good if you go and see yourself. How you preach there and how they call upon. So, you've heard the sermon, go, those who love Christ, come. You're all forgiven, all. They are already the sons of God. Come here to myself, everything is all right. I'll baptize you, you're a saint. Saint. Do you really go as far as this limit? I believe that is all. That is really an endless limit. Alas, what is more, they refer to apostles. Apostles, it looks strange, just strange. I might say comical, if was not tragical. All non-orthodoxy, where is the root of non-orthodoxy? We are already good. Do you hear? We are already good. If I feel there is a shortage of something, as in Catholicism, I may bring the satisfaction to God's justice. Do you hear? What does that mean, to bring satisfaction? I must. Well, I'll bring. If I'm in need of something, I will borrow from someone. Pope will lend me. Do you understand the idea? I'll borrow. I'll acquire corresponding merits from somewhere before God. Merits and super merits. Awful. Oh yes, awful. Protestantism has surpassed even that degree. They have announced themselves saints. And it goes so far as I've read it to you already. Soul doesn't participate in voluptuous deeds. Here, what a beauty. That's all. Do you understand why it is in the West that atheism and materialism appeared? Why did they appear there? Well, it's absolutely clear. It should be realized that where there is no compulsion to live according to what the Gospel says, where such things are being worshipped, what will come out of it? Every sin injures the man's soul. Each sin hardens the person. The man becomes more and more sensitive to God's actions. Human go as far as the condition as they did. They went so far about which Christ told apostles when he asked, Lord, first let me go and say farewell to my parents. Bury my father, and then I'll go and follow you. Do you remember this tough, very tough words? Let the dead bury their own dead. You may go as far as a complete necrosis of the soul when you don't feel anything. Can you speak about grace? What is grace? They say, I never felt what it is like, grace. What I'm speaking about, one God, abstraction and atheism is born, then materialism, at last Satanism. In the final count, everything is absolutely natural, because a man cannot say, at a certain level, surely he will go up or down. Either he turns in a pig or turns it a Satanism at last, his mind being developed on a biological level only. What is it, biological mind? I'll explain it to you. That is a mind of an animal accustomed to the environment. An animal is accustomed to that environment into which you will let it go. A man is accustomed to that very social environment in which he lives. That is a faculty of accommodation, adjustability, purely earthy way of living. Here you see a display of genius, talents, or capabilities, not the slightest hint of a call to God. But this is being advocated, as you see, with the greatest effort, and that very thing that in the West is considered to be a leading, major thing. Here is what the most important is, how to find solutions to such and such problems. You cannot even think of God. He has already saved us. We are saint. If it is not enough, Pope will give me the missing. That is all. Orthodoxy is the last talent of Christianity, which says, a man, turn to your soul, don't kill yourself alive. Here where the grace for you is kept, in yourself, not anywhere else. Forgiveness cannot be considered as some outer action. Forgiveness in Catholicism and Protestantism is an outside feature. I am guilty. God has forgiven me, but I remained such as I was. Clear. Orthodoxy says, no. That is not what it really means. We don't speak about some external form of forgiveness. We mean the healing of the soul from those wounds which we inflict upon us by each sin. Healing is needed, but not as act of forgiveness as such. That is why all not orthodoxy is searching not God, but impunity.
Главное, чтобы не попасть в ад те, которые верят в этот ад. Безнаказанности ищут. Поэтому протестантизме даже я все время.
That is why in Protestantism, but I speak about Lutheranism, because it is the utmost that exists in Protestantism, we find such horrible things. It turns out that God, Father, doesn't see sins of believers, because the piousness of Christ screens God's eyes. Do you understand what they write? If only you will read all this, I believe every normal person could be amazed how it is possible. Unfortunately, you know, 500 years have passed. In 1517, a revolution started, this religion revolution in the heart of the Catholic Church. Millions of millions have been brought up on this. That is the deepest root from which it was impossible to pull the people out, we see and say. How is it possible? Nothing, absolutely. To abandon this is the same as if to take away a tidbit, a tasty morsel. Everything is here. I have said, and they start speaking that the kingdom of God is forcibly taken, and those who force themselves to do it reach it. True, it is written in the Gospel, but what for? We save us by our faith. Apostle Paul writes it in the Epistle to the Galatians, only by faith. Which faith? We say to them, demons believe and tremble, but remain demons. And the conversation goes on like that. It drives to nothing. Here is where the essence of orthodoxy and non-orthodoxy. Is it clear? Thank you. You see how we have elucidated the issue. Question. Why do we call our Patriarch Your Holiness? Is it because that is his higher than all the saints? Answer. No, not because of that. We call him like that, because his mission is called upon this. This is what he should be. Is it clear? We must say that this task is set before man who is elected to this post. You know how we call bishops, your grace, your eminence. To be frank, sometimes I am, due to my malice, middle eminence. But I caught it, of course. But the point is that we mean the highest church service, to what they are called upon. This is not unusual, man. These people are called upon to fulfill their duty in the most holiest way. You know, each man who is occupying a certain post, even a smallest post, is like a driver
who is
sitting at the wheel. A person who is short, he has few people, who is high, he has more people. And at last, Patriarch, he is the wheel of the whole Russia. What kind of man he should be? True, holy, of course. That is the reason.
Вот причина.
Каждый раз, читая слова вечерней молитвы, там есть такая строка, где мы все называем себя...
Question. Each day when we read the words of the evening prayer, we read such phrase. Give me the most humble slave of myself. I feel some pain in my heart because I don't consider myself as such. And attention springs up in myself to change this pride a little. No, I understand. I can't do that. I believe only a saint could be humble. Please explain where I'm not right. Answer. The point is that the prayers that we read are not invocation or exorcism, which we must read by all means only in the way it should be. They can be taken as example to show you what sense we must apply to God. In this given case, towards humbleness or humility. We must be humble before God. That is the sense. I humble myself. Lord, I'll submit, of course. I'll not submit before Sonny Ivanov, of course, never. I'll submit before you. But in this sense, yes, I call myself humble. So by this, I'd like to express my reverence before God, at least in this prayer. If it causes a confusion, okay, we may not pronounce it. These prayers are given as a groundwork, as a guideline. You know, very often, especially before the revolution, there were many people who were illiterate. How could they read the prayers? They were advised to replace these prayers by Jesus' prayer. Oh Lord, Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on myself, sinful, or even shorter. Oh Lord, Jesus Christ, have mercy on me. And the man had not to pronounce it simply and very quickly. And the man had to pronounce it simply and very quickly. Our Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me, but he had to pronounce it with utmost attention, with the fear of God, with reverence. That is, to pray, but not to read it automatically, these very words. You know, this is very important. It is impossible to acquire any true humility, spiritual condition, if we do not pay attention to the correct attitude to our prayer. In particular, Western Catholic saints do not know that. They do not know what should be the prayer like. Here lies the whole misfortune. What is absent here is the sense of repentance, awareness of their sinfulness. Yes, conversion to God with a prayer. It is very hazardous to read prayers automatically, reading them out. That is the most dangerous thing. It is better to read a little, but with full attention and reverence. That is very important. By the way, as far as the children are concerned, we sometimes rejoice and we are moved. Look how well he read our Father. If we don't train them to attention reading, conscious reading, that would end in trouble. We bring up parrots who read now and then. Little time passes and they will grow up. They are sure not to read at all. Only with attentive, sincere reply to a prayer, a man can perceive what is God. As they say, taste and see how good is God. Do you hear? Only a sincere prayer will give us the opportunity to get to know what is God. That is the greatest benefit. God is not somewhere. He is inside us. If you like, you should address yourself inside you. God is there. The kingdom of God is within us. You said this. That is why. That is why attention and reverence are needed, and children must be accustomed to that. God forbid, we should not direct children to read out prayers automatically. It will be hard to withdraw a man from this track. Let's not deceive either yourself or them. Question. That is a question about recently published book Miserable Feeble-Mindedness in Simple Stories by Maya Kucherskaya. Opinions differ as far as this book is concerned. This book is very particular. Many priests think of it negatively, some positively. Have you read this book? What is your opinion on this book? Answer. I have looked through this book. I'll tell you what. Do you remember the gospel? Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Say, would like to consult someone, some expert on some issue. If you want to solve a certain problem, we'll choose an expert, a person who will surely give us an exhaustive answer. If we want to speak about the spiritual life, we must also apply to experts, but not to people taken at random. But you should bear in mind that a book or reading a book is a kind of a talk with this person. And according to this book, it is absolutely clear that it is not a hermit or ascetic. There are no heights. She writes here somewhat beautifully to a certain extent, but is it really what is of interest to us? If we want just to read for the sake of curiosity, we may take an adventure time book. If we want to be taught a spiritual life, it isn't the right thing to push aside Ignatius Brinchaninov and start reading something different. Is it just the same thing? If we apply to someone instead of applying to an expert, they will ask, have you been off your head? Here is the man that is needed, a specialist. Why don't you ask him? This man, taken at random, may cause a lot of fuss. Here is the same thing. No time, I tell you, we're in a difficult situation. An incredible amount of literature is being published. All of it is under the dictum of spirituality, but about that world, and about angels' world, the demon world, and about anything else, we must be very firm and firmly stick to our rules. I'd like to say that one of the reasons why non-Orthodoxy appeared in the West, that is nothing less but the cessation of studying Saint Fathers. And they started being led by whom? So-called new elder, new starets, new teachers, or zealots. So, what is happening? The same thing is in this country. The same misfortune is underway. So, if we just leave Maya alone, she is a woman of the world, and many will see, well, thank God it was written, and it is really worth seeing in the sense that is just in her sense. But when some elders from Athens write, and you don't know, there is no getting away from it. That is the misfortune. I see a book on sale in a church shop called Advisor in Spiritual Life. I looked it through. What does the spiritual leader tell young man? Read Jesus' prayer quickly, 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 in order not to let the devil slip in between the words and embarrass you. And do you know how quickly? An hour hasn't passed when this young man pronounced 3,600 Jesus prayers. Divide and see one prayer, 1 second. Well, try and take a watch and keep pronouncing during an hour. You will say that'll drive you mad. Isn't it true? Where does this man take it from? If you continue reading, you will see from nowhere. There is no such teaching with St. Fathers. On the contrary, our patristic teaching is quite the opposite. This one, Saint Ignatius, writes that you will need about an hour to pronounce 100 Jesus prayers, because each Jesus prayer should be pronounced with attention, with regret in the heart, and with a short pause. O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon the sinful. Do you hear? Half an hour for 100 prayers, 3,600 an hour hasn't passed. Do you hear? This spiritual leader that Jesus prays started from Athens, died in 1990, and you say, Maya, well, you see what we are presented. Another starts the same thing. The book is on sale, beautifully published. Starts Porfiry Kalevit. What do we read there? There are two ways. One is very difficult. Give blood, accept spirit. Struggle with passions, lust, sins. And I consider I've taken an easy way of love to God. And you should follow this way. And further in black and white, he writes, don't fight passions. Don't fight sins. Don't ask God to free you from anything. Do you imagine? Do you hear how he writes this? Beautifully published book in this country as well, translated into Russian. I won't say he has the blessing. I don't want to mention. What gospel? From whom? From Judas. Maybe there's something he said about it. Then this author, Stars Porphyrios, writes about Saint Fathers. I love Saint Fathers, but to tell the truth, I haven't read them. Do you hear where it is driving at? Here is the destruction. Not a single reference, a single father. Personal teaching.
Не зная, не понимая, одно только имя, Афонский старец, и падает.
And people not knowing anything, not realizing anything. Just a name on it, a starts from Athens. They fainted away and accept it as it is. It's already a sacred thing. Just think, they end up with sacrilege. Don't battle with sins, don't battle with passions, choose an easy way of love for God. I've cited Teresa to you, this love for God. You see how careful we should be in this issue. We should read correct literature. Do you hear correct Orthodox literature? You should read Ava Dorofeia's, St. Ignatius Brinchaninov, his writings, his letters. You should read Хеджимос Никон Воробьев.
На толковании надо читать обязательно.
Хеджимос of Schema, Иоанн of Вала. You should read commentaries on Holy Scripture, the Gospel. Take John Chrysostom, Theophan the Recluse, a very good book, published several times. Written by Basil, Bishop of Kinishansky, Debates on the Gospel from Mark. Here is what should be read. There are good interpretations, commentaries on the Gospel written by Ivanov, Theophylact of Bulgaria. You should read people of the Church, undoubtedly. Now we should be utterly cautious with all kind of new and alongside those wonderful meals that we have been nourished, new and new viands are being put in front of us. Some say, do you know these mushrooms? My mouth is watering. I cannot help but eat. The other person keeps saying, poisonous, poisonous, don't eat. And we? What is new? Oh, where is it from? From Athos? Oh. By the way, I'll tell you about this Porphyrios. We have our students there in Greece who called me 3 days ago. I asked him to find out what is the attitude to him in Greece. This Starets Porphyrios who suggests that we should go an easy way without any struggle against anything. Do you hear like in Lutheranism? I've just shown it to you. He is revered in the whole of Greece as a saint man. Do you hear where we are going to? We are, our Orthodox, I'd say, in a critical situation. I don't know in what measure. There, your saint is being translated in this country, and he is being sold in church shops. I tried to ask for it in one of the church shops. I won't tell you in what, in a monastery. They answered to me, many monks consider the books good, and it is being sold out perfectly. Well, I've just thrown up my hands. You cannot go against that sort of argument. It is being sold out well. Do you imagine? Do you understand what sort of things? I say, read page 204. I indicate to you, offer a prayer of Saint Ephraim of Syria. The great land has just passed. We prayed with genuine affliction. O Lord and Master of my life, do not give me the spirit of idleness, despondency, craving for power. And here on the contrary, do not struggle, do not ask. Where is it from? I admit myself, I love Saint Fathers. But to tell you frankly, I have never read them. A remarkable father. You cannot invent anything better. I tell you, it's an awful thing. That is the danger that confronts us. So it doesn't really matter what she wrote. If she had been from Athens, but that's a different matter. But it seems that she hasn't been
there.
I can try and enumerate the awful literature you should not read. Radiant Father, for example. Radiant from the word radio, from the beam. Radiant Father, that Старец Порфирий, whom I mentioned. The spiritual leader, that very person, he recommended that the Jews prayer must be read quickly, in order not to let a devil slip between your words. Excellent. You can imagine what an argument, what strong argument that is extraordinary. Here a monk, Дуримедонда, about obedience, where poor him, this petty monk, by the way, from our Лавра, he went to Athens, and from there he began his critics of Ignatius Брянчанинов. No less, no more. 150 years anyone admired Ignatius as a great spiritual father who had a reason of an angel and those worship, and suddenly this petty monk writes about him. Ignatius doesn't understand the teaching of Saint Fathers about obedience. Just think. In general, I'm under the impression that something is happening wrong with my head. I can't understand anything. Even if you have something else on your heart, keep silent. Not open the stupid thing before the whole world. Oh, he translates Паисио Святогорец, and he probably thinks he understands everything perfectly. Here, here among Дуримедонда and Макария, given by God, by the way. Do you know who has written it? A wonderful name, Дурасов. I do not tell you anything else, but I just give you the name, Макария, given by God. Awful thing. What is more, on some of these books you will find the blessing from, do you hear? From your eminence, your grace, of the most holy persons, do you hear? I asked one of them in private and showed his blessing. He rejected categorically. No, no, no. I haven't given my blessing. I see it for the first time. The other one, this time I can mention his name. He and I were in the same year. He is Archbishop Евлогий Владимир. He says, they bring to me the books with my blessing. Now and then, quite often, but I haven't given them blessing. I haven't blessed them. Do you understand what is the matter? An archbishop? He will not apply to the court. They are crafty people. More, I'd like to say Татьяна Караян, the author of the Jars, archbishop. Well, I'll cite the titles.
Вот это, иеромонаха Трифона, чудеса последнего времени.
Трифон, miracles of the latest times. He, this
иеромонах Трифон, he calls himself a иеромонах.
I do not know of what monastery. He travels around the around all the exhibitions, especially in Moscow, and advertises his writings with all possible means and says, "Let me pray for you. I'll pray for whom? For alive, for departed. Let me pray." You should be thankful for him, of course. Do you understand? You should be thankful. Иеромонах Трифон. Then the book, according to the faith, will it be done to you? This is about the icon, resuscitating Russia. As soon as you see resuscitating Russia about the icon, you must run away. Or window into the celestial world. Phenomena, miracles, and prayers of the last time. Do you hear of the last times? Are you trembling? All these just cunning people, spiritual tasks and admonition of studies. Antonius, one lady calls me from Rome. Here, Antonius Ilyich, you know, what a book, spiritual talks of the starets, I say. What has happened to you? Ah, you mad? The answer. Oh, thank you. What is that? Just a misfortune. They write very crafty, very sweetly, and draw people in. They involve people in. This very Antoni, starets Antoni. Starets Alexei from Penza, the same thing. Some nun of Schema Antonia. I've tested myself in a crucible of sufferings. Who wouldn't be tempted to such a book? Tell me. Well, Филимонов, but deliver us from evil. Or Saint Pelagia of Rязань. I believe some Slava or some boy has revelation. Oh, Маменька, a video cassette in meeting with eternity. Well, it's enough. Otherwise, I'll get it in the neck. That's all. The end. Question. Алексей Ильич, do you consider Лев Николаевич Толстой to be a Christian? If not, why? Answer. I think it's not worth mentioning. Read him. You see what he writes about the church, about his attitude, what awful, insulting things he pronounces. I do not know if Judas was a Christian or not. He was with Christ all the time. He even said, "Rejoice, Rabbi." And even more, what Christian is he? Look at his teaching. He is a Hindu, a real Hindu. Hinduism is very close to him. Ramakrishna, this is his best friend. He completely departed from Christianity, unfortunately. Do not confuse, please, a talent of a writer, which he had undoubtedly, with Christian outlook. But I'll tell you, I've read a lot of his work, but the last book after which I didn't read anything, that was Resurrection. I thought it was a resurrection, but it turned to be a darkness. Since then, I haven't read anything written by him.
С тех пор я его больше не читал.
Ну что у него есть? But he has a lot of remarkable words, undoubtedly. But to call him a Christian, then what is that? Christianity? Then I do not understand. When Christ turns out to be no God, no Son of God, what kind of Christianity is this?
Но избави Бог от такого христианства. Так, пожалуйста.
Как вы считаете, пригодятся ли знания?
Question. What do you think? Whether the knowledge obtained in different fields will be of any use in the kingdom of God? Answer. It depends. In what fields? I think in this field, in this very field, they will be, of course. Arithmetics, I believe, will open itself in another life. Physics, the essence of substance, and arrangement of space, and so on. Now we see in this way, but we study shadows. Apostle Paul writes, like in a mirror, just guessing. In the same way, we'll see everything with unveiled faces. That is why they will be of use in only one sense. We'll say, "Oh God, why we built some fantasies? The world is quite different." And in this sense, they will be of use. We'll see once again how we were far from the genuine cognition of things, I'm not saying God, but things. Question. Yes, the question is about two books, Priest Гармаев and Старец Паисий Святогорец. Words. Answer. Well, about Гармаев, Гармаев started not badly, but he ended badly. He created, literally speaking, a sect of his own. That is why I cannot say anything about his works, his writings, yes. His fortune, by the way, he touched upon such a vigorous subject. Upbringing, education, and he gives resolute advice. Well, this is a real sect, unfortunately. And as far as Паисий Святогорец is concerned, I've mentioned it already, that a star differs from star in splendor. He has a lot of interesting things, useful advice. His works are written in an interesting manner, a vivid talk, practical, topical issues, and etc. But alongside this, there are things that, is to say mildly, cause bewilderment. For example, about the same Porphyrios, he calls upon that not to struggle. He commented, I only black and white TV, but he watched colored TV. Can you imagine a good comparison? No words. But in a word, I would like to say that we are to be serious in relation to any literature. We should not be fascinated. Here he is a story to anybody from somewhere. We must remember, even saint fathers have mistaken views. Saint people made mistakes, undoubtedly, saint, great saints. And of course, we can come across mistaken ideas, inaccurate deliberations, outspoken by modern, even sometimes authoritative stories. This should be borne in mind, and what is more, do you know when Серафимов Серов came out to serve people? He spent several dozens of years in a desert, in a forest. A man being in presence of people constantly, he will never reach that very degree of enlightenment that would keep him from making many mistakes. Absent-mindedness. It is impossible to get rid of it, from this destruction. We all know too well. Modern starets, as a rule, say Паисий. He lived and died in a nun's convent. I visited his grave once. He led a very active life. You see by yourself how many interlocutors, how many people. It is impossible to reach great heights. That is why you may find between very interesting things something that is wrong, untrue, or cause perplexity. What I am calling upon, don't swallow without chewing. You must not take him as an oracle who announces heavenly truth in an absolute meaning. There are no such people who are lighted up by the Holy Spirit in the full sense of the word. Saint Ignatius Брянчанином, Saint Феофан say directly, listen, I'll cite it to you. There are no God-inspired spiritual leaders. Exclamatory remark. We don't believe in that, unfortunately. And when there are none, we create them. And it is especially easy to create this. When you don't see and you don't know this person, and how people often say, the star is from Athens, say, I'd ask, who? The answer, I don't remember. What is that? We have a criterion that differs us from non-Orthodox. And I'll make use of this question to tell you, all the Christians march with the Bible, highly raised above. Once I delivered a lecture, and I was asked to deliver a lecture on in a Baptist seminary in Moscow. There, I asked a very interesting question. All of us use the same Bible, but we have a different understanding of it. Why we differ?
Что же может служить
could serve as a criterion of the correct understanding of the Bible?
Что?
What?
У нас есть
We do have a criterion in Orthodoxy. In Protestantism, there is none.
У нас этим критерием является согласное
patristic consensus, which is being passed from generation to generation,
прямо из поколения в поколение,
right from generation to generation, about priesthood for one. The pupils of apostles said at that time that what apostles had written about their epistles, that was priesthood, sacrament. Protestants repudiate priesthood as a sacrament. I asked, why? Tell me. Here, if we take pupils of apostles, who surely understood the apostles better than anyone, because they personally associated with them, see what they write. That is the end of the first, beginning of the second century. Look, documents, epistles. Do you see priesthood as a sacrament? Then their pupils. Priesthood as a sacrament. Why do you say there is no sacrament? Why?
Молчание.
Потому что так сказал. Because Luther told them. Oh, such a saint.
Протестантизм это.
Protestant have no criterion.
Нет
критерия. There is no criterion.
Сказал один человек.
One person told so, and he is very authoritative. They clung to him. They have no criteria. They have been dispersed like peers into many directions. That is why. We have our patristic understanding of these basic issues, very indisputable criteria. We stopped speaking about whom? Apostles. Then the pupils. Then go on. They have nobody after. They do not recognize the holy tradition of the Church. And from here, the absolute discrepancy in understanding of any other issues. And we know what we have been driving to in the moral sphere, including. English Bishop Barton says euthanasia should be applied for babies, incapable for normal life.
Англиканская церковь прямо
The Church of England directly supported this document and read it to you. An appeal of the Queen Medical College to allow euthanasia for non-viable babies. And a certain bishop, Baxter, declared directly, it would be right to allow euthanasia for the babies who have some aberration or lapse in the health condition. By the way, he didn't even mention which aberrations. Do you understand what kind of things? And what is happening with sodomy in England? They're working out rules according to which not a single department has the right to deny somebody in something that is required under the law. In particular, they cannot deny sodomites in participation in church sacraments, in priesthood. Do you hear? The whole of the Bible is against it.
Вся же Библия. Нет у них, нет уже у них уважения к самой Библии.
They have no respect for the Bible. They have lost this sacred holy tradition we have. But can you imagine in what position these priests of the Church of England, Catholic priests in England, will be placed at the end of the year, when the state law says you have no right to deny? Say, sodomites have come to marriage service in church, a man with a man, or a woman with a woman, and you are obliged to commit holy matrimony. If you don't do it, that's enough. Go to prison. Do you hear how persecution starts? Do you hear where from? Do you see the approach to persecution against the real Christianity? And mind that Russia has no wall now. There is no iron curtain. That is why all these ideas are coming here unimpeded. How soon they will give roots, I don't know. Look what is happening. What is shown on TV? When in Germany, we can witness a big scandal. I deliberately made my notes. It is connected with the fact that a 15-year-old girl was forcefully taken from her parents. The cause for that was that the parents had chosen home education for the girl. The parents rejected the school education after they had come to know the contents of their lessons. Children are offered sexual education. And what is more, they use a lot of visual examples. The parents were indignant by the fact that the pupils were shown video with a recording of sexual intercourse. Besides, children are given educational publications in which they find undisguised poses. Parents came out against that. They were deprived of the parents' rights. Well, how do you find it? Do you hear where the whole history is moving to? In fact, if we depart from Orthodoxy, we do not bring up children in the Orthodox way with all our might. Even the top echelon of power in the state here, there are no Orthodox people, will come to the same point. Look what horrible things, what a leisure. By the way, no one has started thinking, why is that so? Where is that coming from? That is underway. Well, they may say there are sodomites there, not here, but why we should follow them as if being ordered to? Why should we allow these parades? What is the matter? Where is it coming from? It is high time to think. We think very little. It is perfectly clear that in the head of the world government and the world government itself are satanists. The whole power is in the hands of the press. All mass media, they have laws in their hands. It is absolutely clear why and what should be done. Why to show people awful things? Why to show lust to the people? They debauch. That is a question. Why? Now it is clear. Satan can only laugh. What naive people you are. Why you do not understand? Why we can possibly believe in actual existence of Satanism? That it is the cult of Satan. Everything that is being committed is, say, the satanic mass. People are placed according to the powers ordered. We do not understand. Of course, that is not you. You are to be told, but high-ranking officials. But I'm afraid that there as well, there are some people of the kind. Quite possible. Here, what is the matter? That is reality, and we can't explain it by anything else. This persistent pushing through all these anti-gospel principles of life. Here is the trouble that is taking place in the world, and here is what is there in Germany. And really to you, students, guilds, and associations from the three British universities, Exeter, Birmingham, and Edinburgh, resolved to deprive Christian student groups of their membership in the guilds and to withdraw them from the rooms they occupy as they're against homosexuality. How do you like that? What a thing! Where are the human rights? Where is freedom? Freedom and human rights. Get away from here. We'll show you your rights. Question. They say that illnesses and sufferings purify the soul. How does this purification occur? Answer. Purification takes place only in such case when we realize that we accept everything according to our deeds. If we long to tear ourselves from the cross as the left criminal, save yourself, God, and us. No purification occurs, no automatic action in anything. The key is in your soul, depending in what vein we treat everything occurring in our life. Whether we get benefit or harm, we must remember that as far as that is possible to be on the right, together with the right criminal, but not with the loved ones. By the way, that the sincere awareness that we are getting what our deeds deserve when we say that we haven't been betrayed, that they only tripped me up, that I have been dismissed, that I have been slandered, you should realize that not he, not her, not them are guilty. That is God who is acting through these blind tools. Do you hear? If I became aware of this, I'll say, yes, Lord, I deserve that. First, we obtained colossal inner consolation. We'll not suffer to the measure that we had suffered before. Second, God will send us the corresponding deliverance. If we long to get away from the cross, we'll get nothing.